And this is our closing forum, and we've titled it Bridging America's Racial and Policy Divide. And really what I wanted was something that was fairly freewheeling with the panelists here, but also with the audience in terms of how can we use, because we're scholars up here, but how can we use the knowledge that we have to impact public policy? And how can we use the knowledge that we have to help further the cause of justice? And so those are basically the things that I wanna talk about. And I'll start by saying I think that as a historian and as a public intellectual, what I've tried to do, especially as a professor, you have to get tenure, you have to do this deep scholarly work that most of the time the public is never going to read. But you have to do it as an entree into the guild. You gotta write a dissertation, you gotta write a book or two or three, whatever it is you're doing, journal articles. But what I've been doing over the last really 10 years, in addition to that, is really trying to speak to different publics, mm-hmm. Speak to multiple publics about not just African-American history, but also how that history informs contemporary policy debate. So this goes back to when we think about something like Hurricane Katrina. And when Katrina happened in 2005, one of the interesting aspects of the aftermath was the way in which blacks and whites in Louisiana were being treated by the mass media. So African Americans were being called refugees, even though they were citizens. Barbara Bush, the former president, wife of Bush 41, said the refugees never had it so good when they went to the Houston Astrodome. There was such a vilification and a demonization. I think what you saw happen is a lot of people who were African American scholars and their allies really went into the public arena and tried to defend black humanity and tried to defend black dignity. Newspapers had African Americans as looters, and they had whites as just surviving. Just, you know, they're just surviving. It's hard out here for white people just surviving and taking, you know, water bottles. But black people who did it were looters. So I think what I've tried to do in terms of my own work is really dive into public debates over race and racism, even, you know, before we got to this Black Lives Matter moment. And that was a way of trying to bridge that divide and not stay in the so-called ivory tower or the ebony tower, where you have all this knowledge and the only people you share it with are the limited and really relatively privileged students that you have. So one of the things that I've done is really speak to a number of different groups, including a bunch of youth groups. And those talks are always free. I've tried to make sure my books are distributed widely for free to young people. I've spoken at prisons, and prisons are really important because when you speak at a prison, many of those people in prison view you as a lifeline, and they don't get a chance to have this kind of knowledge. When you go to a max facility, they don't have access to the internet. Their books are very much curtailed, and they're very, very in need of an anchor. So that's been very important too. But young people has been important. I think one of the biggest things that we haven't done as a nation is share the story of American history, and it's most important, I think the most important social movement in American history is the movement for civil rights broadly, mm-hmm. right? And our young people don't know that story, right? And I think part of what you see when you see violence in Ferguson, when you see the debilitating rates of illiteracy in black communities even now in 2016 is connected to young people not knowing the story. Black boys, if they're not at reading level, grade level by the age of 8 in the third grade, they are more likely to be on a road to prison, probation, parole. And that's why we're trying to do early intervention. But the early intervention they're trying to do now with the My Brother's Keeper program, it's just private philanthropy over 5 years. So it's not federally sponsored. It's not our taxpayer dollars because of the historical and contemporary political moment we live in. But that's really, really crucial. So sharing this story, but then also writing op-ed pieces, doing local and public media, just trying to get the voice of a scholar out there in a way that the public can understand, I think is crucially, crucially important. Because who we're writing to as we continue on in our professional careers really changes and transforms. I think initially you're trying to write to fellow scholars and colleagues, especially in your discipline. I'm a historian. But as you grow and expand, you're really seeing, you're trying to get this knowledge out to a wide range of people, right? As wide as possible, especially because what we're talking about is connected to politics and public policy in such a tangible way. So when you're writing about mass incarceration, it's really not just history, it's also history and what's happening in contemporary public policy all around us. So I think that, and I'll close, one of the things that I'm interested in asking my colleagues is, what ways are you trying to bridge that divide? And you know, what are some of the tensions there too? Because you do have to get tenure, you do have to be a professional. The academy loathes activism. I consider myself a scholar activist in the Du Bois framework and in the Anna Julia Cooper, Lorraine Hansberg, scholar activists. But the academy, and by the academy I mean universities, they loathe activists, right? They don't want disruptors unless those disruptors are going to make them $1 billion. Then they love the disruptors, right? Because they become the big donors. Because we don't love disruption unless it's Silicon Valley. You know, you say, man, Uber disrupted it. It's worth $50 billion. They're like, that's good. But if you're protesting, you know, hands up, don't shoot. They're like, man, like, what do you want? You know, like, I was in class. And I remember when the Black Lives Matter folks in New York City, and it went viral, they went to a breakfast spot in New York City. It was a bunch of white folks. And they, like, shut it down. And people were like, we're eating our breakfast. You know what I mean? Like, no, it was brunch. That's why it was so important. It was a brunch spot. It was a brunch spot. And people were like, man, I can't believe they disrupted my brunch for protest. And you know, I think disruption is good. Disruption is how we've transformed American society. Nonviolent civil disobedience was crucially important to getting massive legislation passed. And I think we forget that when we sort of claim that people who are disrupting our normal routine because of protests are somehow being unfair or putting us out, and we don't understand sort of the messiness of social and political movement. So I'll close with that, but that's what I want to dialogue about, really, and not just with us up here, but with you down there, with you up there. How can we do that? How can we bridge this? Because I think everybody who tries to come to events like this is interested in making an impact, is interested in making a positive impact.
So I'm next. So I was just informed at the end of the last panel that, I don't know if people in the room know about this, but a young African-American unarmed kid named David Joseph was killed last night here in Austin, found naked for disobeying. And I think, you know, we've been taught, the last panel, Dr. Joseph talked about the need to address black equality and the need to put black equality front and center at the domestic policy table. The way that I see it, the ways in which the federal policymakers mobilized the war on crime, the war on drugs, the war on terror over the past half century promotes a particular type of social control that signals that the targeted arrest of people of color and the creation of new industries to support this new regime of control is really the central characteristic of domestic policy in the last over the last half century, and that's why placing black equality front and center is incredibly important. Policymakers, as I mentioned in my earlier remarks, across the political spectrum, made decisions that in closed circles, in closed rooms, that had immeasurable consequences for low-income Americans on the ground and the nation. However unintended those consequences may have been at different times and at different moments. But ultimately, we, in terms of our urban social policies, we've been fixated on policing urban space and eventually removing entire generations of young people of color from their communities to live inside prison. So we can excuse these sets of actions, the decisions that led to these developments as a product of their time or as electoral tactics. But if we do so, we'll continue to avoid addressing the legacies of enslavement that still prevent the nation from really living up to the full promise of its founding values. And this is exactly what Peniel was talking about in the last panel. We can't begin to move forward unless we deal with the legacies of enslavement and dispossession. Until recently, you know, many of the devastating outcomes of these policy choices have really gone unnoticed. For many, it seemed as though discrimination kind of ended with the civil rights movement, and the United States had moved beyond race-based systems of exploitation. And you know, that this is in part because of the, and we talked about this in the last panel too, kind of the measures of outcomes, the fact that there's a formidable black middle class that surfaced, and that African Americans are now in positions of power with greater visibility, from the rise of black mayors in the 70s to the displays of black wealth for popular consumption to Barack Obama's presidency. And these achievements further promoted the discourse of cultural pathology and personal responsibility, making it seem as though the incarceration of entire groups of people was somehow reflected the natural order of things. So, you know, we're here because we all recognize that political representation and the fact that some African Americans have amassed substantial wealth and capital doesn't mean that historical racism has ended. Even though African Americans grew more affluent as a group after 1965, by the end of the 20th century, the net financial assets of the highest fifth of black households was $7,448. This is only about $450 above the lowest fifth of white American households. And of course, this black middle class has always been concentrated in the public sphere and social services, where mobility is tied to the extent of government spending on domestic programs. So this month and every February, we celebrate the racial inclusion championed by African Americans and their allies in classrooms. But the fact that many of the critical reforms of the post-war period have been negated by national crime control priorities remains unrecognized. For instance, 9 years after the passage of the Voting Rights Act that I mentioned in my earlier comments, at the dawn of the age of mass incarceration, the Supreme Court ruled it constitutional to deny convicted felons the right to vote. And so states have consistently removed convicts from the voter rolls ever since this 1974 decision, Richardson v. Ramirez. So today, and I mentioned this before, but it's worth repeating, that 6 million Americans, 6 million, who most of whom have already served their sentences, won't vote. They're denied the franchise. An estimated 1 out of 13 African Americans will not vote in the 2016 election. And because of this felon disenfranchisement and the sets of policies behind it, a key civil rights gain has come undone. So this is an example of the ways in which this erodes our democracy. And to make this already questionable situation worse, the U.S. Census counts people who are incarcerated in state and federal prisons as residents of the county where they are serving time, and then census counts in turn determine representation. So although rural areas are home to the minority of the U.S. population, they're home to the majority of prisons. So urban Americans who tend to favor Democrats lose representation because of how felon disenfranchisement works, and rural districts who favor Republicans gained extra representation because of how the prison system works. So this has literally changed American democracy and American history. We know in Florida, for example, Al Gore would have certainly won in 2000. It had those who had already served their sentences been able to vote. Meanwhile, as this mobility remains stagnant, public schools in many urban neighborhoods are more segregated today than they were before. the civil rights movement. So in thinking about how we in this room and we who do research on these issues can kind of make the work, make our work relevant and make our values relevant, I think we really need to revisit the issue of community representation and grassroots empowerment that guided the development of the Great Society in order to think about moving towards a more equitable and just nation. The Johnson administration included grassroots representatives and organizations in the administration of social welfare programs, but this was a policy directive that proved to be fleeting. Promising initiatives that had been designed by grassroots organizations and that received federal funding directly during the first few years of the War on Poverty were increasingly required to include public officials and municipal authorities in top-level positions, especially after the Watts Uprising in August 1965. So essentially, before, a lot of the community action programs were given the chance to really work on a wider level for entire communities instead of for many individuals who benefited from them. Federal policymakers decided to kind of defund them and switch course, and then police officers came to take a more prominent role in urban social life and in social services. So we can only imagine what the United States might look like today if the federal government, the bipartisan political consensus, mobilized behind the principle of maximum feasible participation that steered the War on Poverty's community action programs at the same level of commitment as they mobilized behind the War on Crime. So, once the Nixon administration moved to terminate the Office of Economic Opportunity at the center of the War on Poverty and increasingly partnered its activities with the Law Enforcement Assistance Administration at the center of the War on Crime, community involvement in federal social programs was largely relegated to the law enforcement realm. So even within the crime control apparatus, only about 2% of the grants the federal government awarded to police departments went to tenant patrols and other community-based programs. The White House and the Department of Justice, federal policymakers were really more interested in supporting programs that would lead to an increase of patrol of low-income communities, surveillance, new law enforcement technologies. So put bluntly, and I think this is the kind of key policy point here, due to their own shared set of assumptions about race and their unwillingness to disrupt the racial hierarchies that had defined the social, political, and economic relations of the United States historically, the bipartisan consensus that launched this punitive intervention did not believe that African Americans were capable of governing themselves. Nixon expressed this sentiment overtly to his chief of staff, Harry Haldeman, when he said, quote, "There has never in history been an adequate black nation, and they are the only race of which this is true." In a less conspicuous form, Jimmy Carter stressed grassroots participation as a critical component of his urban social program, which essentially implemented new levels of surveillance in public housing projects in the name of security. Yet he didn't fund community-based organizations such as the League to Improve the Community in Chicago's Robert Taylor Homes, which really was advocating the exact same strategies that the federal government was, but sought to do it autonomously. And then when Ronald Reagan took office, the rhetoric of community involvement vanished from the domestic policy arena, never to really return. And I think that now we're in a moment where we can see that there's an entree for it to return. Stemming from this punitive shift in urban social programs during the previous decade, over the course of the 1980s, law enforcement officers came to provide the primary and in some cases the only public social services to residents. And as the first line of contact between government authorities and the public, police officers assume various duties depending on where they're patrolling. So we've talked about this some, but you know, in segregated low-income communities, the task of police is to search for suspects and remove offenders and potential offenders from the streets. In suburban and white communities, it's to protect property. So this is in part why this kind of differential policing is part of the reason why we see such gross racial disparities in our criminal justice system. And of course, this ends up polarizing both residents and law enforcement authorities. Only about 4% of the sworn police officers who fought the war on crime during the second half of the 60s were of African American descent, which is a very low figure given the overrepresentation of African Americans in the criminal justice system. So Yuhiro brought this up in his brilliant keynote speech, but it's worth saying again, James Baldwin's point that the only way to police a ghetto is to be oppressive. For black residents, as Baldwin writes, police officers represented the force of the white world and that world's criminal profit and ease. To keep the black man corralled up in here, in its place, like an occupying soldier in a bitterly hostile country. So with suspicion on both ends, the problem, as Baldwin identified it, lay not with the individual police officer, but in the systemic forces that supported questionable and sometimes deadly policing practices. The response of outside forces on the beat in Black and Latino urban areas and the response of residents, the presence of those forces, were both the outcomes of historical developments and socioeconomic circumstances. Yet the officer had few alternatives but to act in the manner in which she or he had been trained. More than a half century after Baldwin's insights, aggressive policing practices and mass incarceration have become, as we've been saying, the foremost civil rights issue of our time. So instead of being criminalized, low-income citizens must be empowered to change their own circumstances and fully integrated into public institutions at all levels. I think crime control is a local matter and that residents should be responsible for keeping their own communities safe. Various national reforms, such as police body cams, only continue the use of taxpayer dollars to fund new equipment for police forces, and this process began during Johnson's war on crime. So without question, the militarization of American police and the over-policing of Black neighborhoods is a policy path that has proven highly unsuccessful as a crime reduction strategy. It hasn't worked to reduce crime. And it fuels mass incarceration instead and the justice disparities within it. So now I think is really the time that we can try new directions. As I mentioned this in the last panel, but from requirements for police, basic training and training requirements to civilian review boards to autonomous grassroots social programs to job creation measures for at-risk youth instead of job training measures. And I think that then we can begin to finally confront the entrenched systemic inequalities and civil liberties violations that exist within the criminal justice system, as well as the persistence of inequality in America. So I'm wrapping up here, but outrage over the death of unarmed African American citizens, most recently here in Austin, David Joseph, but those really in the year after the death of Michael Brown and after the Ferguson outbreak alone, and I'm gonna say their names, Ezell Ford, Dante Parker, Akai Gurley, Tamir Rice, Laquan McDonald, Natasha McKenna, Tony Robinson, Anthony Hill, Megan Hockaday, Maya Hall, Walter Scott, Freddie Gray, Alexia Christian, Sandra Bland, Sam Dubose, and Christian Taylor. And these are the ones that we know about. Has set a new climate for us to come together today for new social movements and for federal action. The conditions that gave rise to the police encounters that ended in the loss of each of their lives and the lives of thousands of others that will never be known would not have existed and could have been avoided entirely had the federal government decided to respond in a different way to the civil rights movement and enlightened protests of the 1960s. Questions of intent or the degree to which federal policymakers foresaw the consequences of the choices they made with respect to urban social programs in Black communities are only relevant to a certain extent. The issue for us, I think, as thinking about how we can use our work to bring about the kind of changes we want to see, is to uncover the series of decisions that made the injustices that we see in our society today possible in order to discover our own actual history. The punitive domestic policies of the last half century have shaped the lives of Black women and men, their families, and their communities. And these policies will shape life prospects for Black children and their children's children, even if the criminal justice system is transformed once again. And so as we think about criminal justice reform today, we need to come to terms with the fact that ending the war on drugs, as Peniel said, will not resolve the nation's police and prison problems. We're still gonna be the leading incarcerator of the world, even if we release all of the drug offenders from our prisons. As long as law enforcement remains at the forefront of domestic urban policy and remains focused on young urban citizens of color, the regressive impulses of the last half century will continue to erode American democracy. Barring fundamental changes at the national level, and it must be at the national level, the cycle of racial marginalization, socioeconomic isolation, and imprisonment is ever more likely to repeat itself. That said, I'm hopeful that we'll bring about more justice and peace this year. Happy Black History Month. Thank you.
All right, Laurence.
Thanks again, Peniel, for the opportunity to speak. And in this particular closing forum, Peniel's asked, well, really challenged us to think about the relationship between our disciplines and social policy. And it's difficult for me, trained as an anthropologist, to think about that connection. Partially it's because the way that I was trained, and I think most anthropologists are trained, in the US at least, is to have your work address a theoretical problem that people within the discipline care about. And so if you address a theoretical question that is divorced from something that's on the ground, a material reality, that's not only expected, but it's privileged. So if you have your research address an actual problem that's affecting people in the ground, that's less valued within the discipline. Mm-hmm. But there's no reason why those two things can't or should be divorced. There are theoretical questions that have implications for real world problems. And it's still things that people could care about within the discipline. So that's something I try to do, but it's not something that's widely sought after in my discipline, right? So I think this opportunity is important for me as a scholar, but for I think a lot of social scientists to be challenged to talk to people in public policy to try to make their work translatable on a different level. My research for my first book, Renegade Dreams, Living Through Injury in Gangland Chicago, was based on a gang that had a 50-year history in a community on the west side of Chicago that I worked with and studied. And so I think part of the kind of concept that I was working with was a theory of injury, right? I was trying to develop this concept of what I called social injury. And I want to talk about a couple of ways where I tried to kind of expand the notion of injury. I think one, the central way that I tried to do it in the book was that I worked with gang members who had been disabled as a result of gun violence. And these particular gang members, a group of them, would go around to high schools and churches and events where at-risk youth would be and talk about what it was like to live with a disability. What struck me about this group was that they weren't making a kind of moral argument. It wasn't a kind of scared straight message. They were just literally talking about the medical realities of living with a disability, how they had to raise off their wheelchairs every now and then to relieve pressure sores in their bodies, how a catheter worked, how an enema worked, how their family relationships have changed since they became disabled. And kind of using them as an example, I wanted to study how people kind of use the injuries they've suffered as a resource. And I have thought that, you know, what are the other ways that people in this community are using the injuries that they've experienced as a way to try to solve problems within their neighborhood? Another way this was happening was around the issue of gentrification. This was a community that had a high rate of incarceration. It was one of three neighborhoods in Chicago where when people get out of prison, that's where they go to. It was a 70% high school dropout rate in the community. 42% of the people were living below the poverty line. And this neighborhood had a kind of unique architectural infrastructure. It was the one neighborhood in Chicago that had the most concentration of what they call gray stones buildings. It would be brown stones in like in New York. So heavily stone structures that, you know, are very attractive. A lot of these parcels were abandoned and people couldn't afford them, boarded up. But a lot of them, people were living in them and they had owned them for generations. Not surprisingly, it was people wanted to come in there, get them out, and rebuild the neighborhood because it was close to the downtown Chicago. And so what was happening is that the local government, the municipal government, was characterizing certain houses as dilapidated. Mm-hmm. And once they characterized them as dilapidated, then the government could seize the property, kick the people out. So the people in this neighborhood were going around with the city's acquisition list, the list of houses within the neighborhood that were characterized as dilapidated, and they were taking pictures of the houses themselves, and they were going to City Hall and say, look, this house is characterized as dilapidated, but nothing's wrong with it. There's no violations. Why is it characterized as dilapidated? And they were getting houses off the list, right? So that's another way in which people were kind of using the stigma of their neighborhood, losing the stigma of their kind of crime-infested, gang-infested, heavily incarcerated neighborhood to try to invert that narrative. The final example I want to talk about is maybe the most provocative example. A number of long-term residents in the community were trying to create a gang museum. Now, as I said, this gang in this neighborhood had been around for 50 years. When I first started doing research in the neighborhood, there were 70-year-old gang members who I was working with in violence prevention programming, and they were still claiming gang affiliation. And so this, you know, surprised me. And, you know, it was a number of contradictions that came in my mind. One is, how can you be a gang member working in violence prevention when most of the violence is taking place between gangs? Second, why would you be claiming gang affiliation when you're 70 years old? Obviously, you're not the person on the street that is enacting the violence. And the pushback that I got was that, look, this gang has a 50-year history, and it hasn't been all violent. And so when I'm claiming gang affiliation, what I'm actually doing is saying that the gang doesn't have to be this way, and the gang hasn't always been this way. So a number of the older gang members were trying to have a gang museum where they could showcase the gang's political past, their involvement in the civil rights movement, their involvement in the Black Panther movement, the way that they were feared by the government for their political potential, not because of their drugs and their guns. And so creating this museum was another way to kind of invert that idea of injury and try to make it a resource that other people can draw upon and use to change their neighborhood. Now, when looked at all of these instances, there's a number of public policies, initiatives that you can draw from it, you know? I didn't like study the efficacy of the disabled gang members' presentations on a systematic basis. I couldn't tell you if they actually transformed the hearts and minds of those young gang members. I could tell you that a number of the houses on the acquisition list actually got taken off, and that had material consequences for a number of families. But I think the wider point is, at least for me in this book, is something that Elizabeth mentioned, which is to kind of counteract the idea that African Americans don't have a say in how they are governed, or don't have a say in their public policy, or don't have a say in the lives that they envision for themselves. Okay, thank you. And so I think for me, that's the biggest kind of public policy intervention, at least in this work, is the broad notion that people do, even low-income gang members, have an idea of how to solve violence in their communities. Even people that are living below the poverty line have an idea about housing and what their neighborhood should look like. Even people who have been in gangs for 50 years have an idea of the kind of initiatives that can change the outlook of young people in their community. And I think that if we discount them from the start, then we miss a real opportunity to create change in these neighborhoods. The research that I'm working on now has to do with police violence in Chicago. And I'm really looking at it over a long period from the 1980s to the present. And looking at kind of police torture cases to the kind of initiatives that people are doing now to make police violence a human rights issue. And what I worry about in this instance, in terms of public policy, is a kind of repetition of the same solutions, a lack of imagination about what other solutions could be in a kind of intractable faith in policing itself, right? The benefit of the doubt given to police officers, even though we have this long history. And so there have been reports before that exposed the police violence in Chicago. There have been commissions. There have been, firing of chiefs of police and all these kind of things, and that won't solve the problem. You know, for me as an anthropologist, I kind of look at the institutional culture of policing, look at the incentive structure for how you rise up the ranks. And so if it's based on an incentive structure in which you make rank by, through stop and frisk. You get money through the number of people that you detain and lock up. Then that's going to skew the way that people police in urban neighborhoods, right? Whereas if you incentivize the kind of a de-escalation of violence, we don't know what would happen because we don't do that, right? And so what I'm trying to do is kind of develop another imagination about how we can think about these solutions that change the way that, we think about policing, even within the precincts themselves. Stop there.
Great. Thank you. All right, so this is great. This is now based on you guys' questions. We'll be here as long as you guys want, and if not, We will wrap up. Yeah. So this is not a forced class where you gotta.
Hi, I'm Naomi Reed. I'm with the Institute of Urban Policy Research and Analysis at Black Studies here at UT. I kind of wanted to follow off of Lawrence's comment because I too am trained as an anthropologist, and being in a policy institute, the divide between sort of ethnographic narratives and the way that policy gets made is something I've been made very aware of in this position. And I just have a more immediate question. We've been talking about Black Lives Matter for 2 days, and I'm just wondering if there was any sort of thought to bringing Black Lives Matter Austin to the conference, or people from the Capitol, maybe seeing academia as a space of convergence for those two perspectives.
I think everybody was invited, and they were definitely welcome to come. I haven't made connections with Black Lives Matter Austin, particularly, except on Facebook. But absolutely, definitely open to having, and in the future, folks from the Capitol. We're going to have the grassroots activists and the legislators here, but also the academics and some of the policy people. But in a broad range, because I think Laurence's work really does connect. When I read Renegade Dreams, and it's a very important book, I think it really connects with the urban policy that I read too, except that those two disciplines aren't necessarily always in conversation with each other, because he's saying a whole lot about not just gang violence and poverty, but gang violence, poverty, disability, the criminalization of Black youth, and also the hyper-segregation that these communities face. And then really the like in Harlem, and he's dealing with the west side of Chicago, what gentrification really means. You know, gentrification is just another iteration of white supremacy. And it's happening in Boston, it's happening in New York, it's happening in places that I grew up. It's just another iteration, because white supremacy and its institutions are what corral Black and brown people and these bodies into segregation. And then, if the moment is propitious enough, it's what then says, and we saw it with Ratner City in New York, in Brooklyn. And you know, Jay-Z, they were connected to all of this in the sense that people were thrown out of rent-stabilized homes to build the New Jersey Nets, which is now the Brooklyn Nets, their stadium. And there was a lot of protest, and there was one guy who owned an apartment there. The city tried to do eminent domain and buy it for $500,000. He held out and eventually sold it to Ratner. He was the last person in the building for $3 million, right? And so I think there's a lot of policy implications there in his work. And we rarely talk about disability vis-a-vis low-income African-American men and women, let alone teenagers, really boys and girls who, because of the way they're living, almost never had a chance. Yet they're still, I mean, the way he describes it in terms of renegade dreams, they still have hope, and they still are trying to have impact, even though many of them don't have access to motorized wheelchairs and, I mean, you know, all these different things that we think of with the physically challenged.
Just to add to that and the point about kind of the divide between, I think, scholars and academics, you know, after the Nixon administration, really, there was this time during the war on poverty. I mean, part of the reason why the war on poverty was so successful, because policymakers were interested in bringing scholars into the policy table. Yeah. Scholars were very important in terms of shaping policy. In the mid-70s, that has kind of gone away. Now, instead of, you know, prominent professors and experts testifying at Senate hearings, you have lobbyists and things like that. So that's something that I hope will begin to change, and that's been, you know, long in existence, I think, in is part of, you know, why we have such a limited view of what's possible today, because we're not included, we're not invited to those policy discussions in a way that we that scholars, you know, who anthropologists, historians, sociologists were in an earlier period.
Mm-hmm. I'm coming. Thank you. Hi, I'm Diane McWhorter. I'm a journalist. Picking up on what you said, Elizabeth, though, is that partly the fault of the university, though? I was so struck being in academia, on the fringes of academia for 4 years, just how much knowledge was bottled up in there. And I always wondered whether Harvard had, like, somebody getting Bill Wilson's research out there, you know, to policymakers. Do they?
Well, yeah. I mean, he's connected, and he was definitely connected with the Clinton administration, less so the Obama administration, although they know, of course, course, who he is. But no, I agree that the ivory tower at times precludes the kind of interaction and conversation you need with the public, even at public policy schools, you know? I mean, we're trying to do more so. This is an example of really deep scholarly and community engagement in public history and policy discourse that people need to do. And, you know, in the future, we hope to have it even more jam-packed as once we have different circuits and networks of publicity here, because this is brand new. This is our first effort, and we hope to build deeper ties. But I agree that we don't do it enough. And part of it is that the university doesn't reward public engagement.
That's just so, it's apropos what you were saying about it's a guild and that you all speak the same language. I mean, some of the lectures I would go to, an academic would ask a question, I would just have no idea what they were talking about, but the speaker would, and it was just a language. And a very celebrated history professor at Harvard said, if you want to get tenure at Harvard, don't dare be caught writing an op-ed, you know? And I just thought, God, that is sick. That's what you're supposed to be doing is.
But this is changing. One thing, the positive of all the millennials and Laurence, Elizabeth, all this young energy, Brandon was here, is the usage of social media. And also one of the things I'm convinced that, because I'm seeing them come to the academy through the academy now, brilliant folks in their 20s, and some of them, including my students. They think differently, so the academy is going to change. It's going to have to change. They connect their scholarship and their studies with social engagement, and they're social people. They're interested, so they're tweeting, they're Instagramming, they're doing all that stuff. But we almost act like that generation isn't also producing scholars and writers and all these brilliant people, and they are. And so they're not going to get to these institutions and think to themselves that I'm not going to engage in the public. They're doing it. They're pushing, African American Studies, Anthropology at Harvard, History, FM at Harvard. They're pushing it, and they're going to push these policy schools too, because the future is engagement. People, the interesting part, and Robert Putnam, who's at Harvard, talks about this in terms of bowling alone, but then the new stuff. On some levels, we've become more disengaged from each other because we're setting up affinity communities nationally, right? So we just want to be around, you know, I think Elizabeth is great, Laurence is great, and we're like, that's it, we're good. You know what I mean? So we got our friend Steph, Diane, these are my people, we're going out to dinner afterwards, and then the rest of the world, we're like, what? You know, they're not invited, you know, unless we find out that they have deep affinity networks too. But at the same time, so that's one. But it's juxtaposed against the fact that what's interesting is that young people want ever deeper, more engagement. And they talk about this. They talk about how they don't want the superficial engagement of social media. They want something deeper. And so what's happening, I think, and we could see it through what they were calling, my students were calling actions, where they would do Black Lives Matter, BLM, and other protests. They did that wanting real engagement. They wanted to be engaged, and they were trying to change the world, but they did it in a way that was both similar to when you think about sit-ins of the 60s, but also transcendent of that, too. So they were both building on that, and certainly in the 60s, they didn't shut down highways. I mean, they're shutting down highways in Miami and Boston and Oakland and Washington, D.C., and we, you know, the movement didn't do that in the 1960s.
Diane Nash proposed it after the Birmingham church bombing.
But they didn't do it. And that was the interesting folks. These folks did it, and that's the are doing. And I think this is extraordinary in that sense. But the engagement is happening, and it's gonna happen on an even bigger level.
Thank you. So bright, so insightful, all of you. Thank you so much. Before I forget, Ivory Perry in St. Louis actually did shut down a freeway, and I don't know. I can't remember if it was 67 or something like that. So so it's happened, you know, at least once before, but it wasn't regular like you
on
see.
This scale, yeah.
Yeah, definitely. But Professor Ralph, I'm so fascinated with your research and the book that you wrote. It reminds me of David Dolly, who this guy from Dartmouth went down to hang out with the conservative vice lords and embedded himself in, you know, in the 60s, this kind of thing. That eventually led to some of those vice lords going to Dartmouth, actually. But what's fascinating is David Dolly was a white fella who went to embed himself with this, you know, Woodlawn gang, I guess, or Youth Nation, or whatever you refer to it as. I'm interested in how you were able to, you know, I don't know, gain access, embed yourself. I know it's a silly question, but could you speak to it at least? I mean, I'm not stereotyping you or anything like that, but I don't. Well, anyhow, just tell me how the process went.
So I think the Nation of Lords that you're talking about, book by David Dolly, was a groundbreaking gang book. But it really documents what Elizabeth was talking about during the kind of war on poverty, where you actually had youth group organizations getting money from the government to do community service programming, including gangs, right? And so this leads to your next question. So I got kind of introduced to my neighborhood that I worked in through gang prevention, or violence prevention, not gang prevention. And so it was in violence prevention where I met this generation of older gang members, right? And they were the recipients of the programs that David Dolly talked about. So they had this conception of the gang as having, you know, entrepreneurial organizations, reform schools, small businesses. And so they had this wide, expansive idea of what could be in the neighborhood, right? Now, their take on it was that, like, if the young people just knew this, then they could do it. And it wasn't a kind of idea that, the structure has fundamentally changed, so there are not opportunities. Gangs and have been demonized in a way that it would be outrageous for somebody, a government official, to say, look, I'm going to give you money after the crack epidemic. That's foregone conclusions, not going to happen. But they were still envisioning a gang that could do that, right? So on one hand, there's these twin challenges. Like, how do you expand people's imagination about what could be, but at the same time recognize that the ground has shifted, mm-hmm. and that belonging to the gang now doesn't mean the same thing as it did in the 60s when Dolly was there, you know? And so that's some of the challenges that I was dealing with. But really, the short answer is that through these older members, I got to know their grandsons and granddaughters and nephews who were active gang members in the neighborhood, and eventually moved into the neighborhood. And I worked at a number of different community organizations, local churches, the juvenile detention center, rehabilitation center, and I got to know young people that were heavily involved in gangs. But in Chicago, if you want to know the kind of, there's no way to deal with the problem of youth violence and youth crime without addressing the gang question in Chicago. So it was kind of something that I couldn't not see once I was interested in crime and incarceration and violence.
So I had a, my name is Maureen Anway. I'm a student here at the LBJ School. So when you're talking about bridging academia and experts to policymakers, one of the things I've thought a lot about here as a student is to what extent is it that it's, you know, I think it's often framed as, oh, we need to connect them. But I feel like in the state of Texas, a lot of legislators don't want to hear what experts have to say. Yeah. I'm really interested in migrant farm workers. I don't think anybody denies the fact that they have it economically really hard, and I don't think another study is going to change that. So how do you, one, distinguish between when it's a connection problem versus, like, a listening problem, and what do you do about it?
Yeah, no, I hear what you're saying. In terms of, I'll push back in terms of the studies. We always need up-to-date research, you know, so you always need up-to-date research. Because what a migrant farm community might have been going through in Texas, a specific locale just 5 years ago, has been fundamentally transformed. And you'd have to use your research and your data to see how it's been transforming. The economy is always changing. There's technological innovation. Migrant workers, there are many who are undocumented workers, and you think about immigration. And ICE, and you know, we could look at a year by year and look at data of how many have been deported, how many have been detained by ICE, how many workers are being needed, required seasonally by institutions that hire them. And so you always need the data. No, that's a good point. I mean, I think in Texas, you know, and anywhere, it's going to be complicated. So you at the start are going to need to connect with people you have some kind of, you can find a common ground with. Because right now, like Elizabeth was saying, nationally, the common ground is that both Democrats and Republicans feel, for different reasons, and that's where you had the Koch brothers and Center for American Progress get together, that there's too many people who are being incarcerated for too long, for too little reason, to sort of paraphrase Eric Holder. So that's a common ground. Now, the devil is in the details. Radical groups would like to see an utter, you know, restructuring, including of the federal burn grants that are the criminal justice grants, and change those from grants that incentivize arrest and sting operations on black folks and brown folks into things that are really focused on rehabilitation and community building. But the big thing there is that we'd have to discuss how do we transform policing, because I agree with what people were saying earlier, that policing should have a mental health component. Policing should have, and for a while we talked about that vis-a-vis the war on poverty, but like Elizabeth saying, it got superseded by just crime and punishment, just very, very punitive. And you know, are the police even situated to provide the mental health facilities, or would you redirect billions that have gone into policing and sort of drug interdiction into community health and into mental health and into playgrounds and things like that? You know what I mean? And so that's a big, and then what would that do? You know, Michelle Alexander has argued that if you transform the criminal justice system, a million people lose their jobs, especially, you know, in the Midwest. But you would transform the parole system. You would transform the court system. So you have to understand, like, people are incentivized. It's like, we are professors and faculty. We don't want to lose our jobs. If they're saying there's some big policy here where robots are going to teach you, that doesn't sound great, you know? So I think the way in which you do it, you have to find here legislative or policy partners who see and converge with you on your interest in terms of migrant workers. And again, this is going to be a tougher state, just because right now there's a demographic explosion awaiting in Texas, but it's not here in Texas. So you're going to have, you think about somebody like Julian Castro. In another context, there might be the demographics where somebody like that could be side by side with Ted Cruz. And so you guys would have Ted Cruz as one of your senators and Julian Castro as another. Or maybe Julian Castro is governor and Ted Cruz is senator. I think that Texas does have, you know, those different perspectives. But right now, demographically, statewide, it's very tough for people who are pushing some kind of progressive politics to win in an election statewide. You can be mayor of San Antonio, you can be a congressperson, but statewide, it's much more difficult. So you'd have to find somebody, and maybe people who are connected to Austin municipal politics, who would be more willing to listen to that, and not necessarily even state politics. Maybe you start out very, very local to see what you can do and what effect you can have. Because I think you can have. But I also agree with you that there's people who aren't listening. But remember, you can movements and social movements can force people to listen, and that's what we're seeing now. Because these young people and there's obviously middle-aged people and older people who are involved in the movement. But I think what's happened over the last 24 months is that younger people have entered in a big way. In an ongoing dialogue that's always been there. So it's a long-running saga, but what they've done, and when you think about the long-running saga, we think about Moral Mondays in North Carolina, where you have veteran civil rights activists who are bringing, you know, 300, 1,000, 3,000 people to the Capitol to protest cuts, right? And this is happening all over the country, yet the BLM activism became so hugely disruptive that by December of 2014, BLM activists and the folks who were around the anti-racist criminal justice reform movement were called into a meeting with Obama. Obama never met the Moral Mondays people. So they got a meeting in December. You know, Phil Agnew wrote about it, but Brittany Planquette, all these people were there. They were there because there was a crisis that even the president is like, well, let me meet with these folks. Mm-hmm. And you're like, well, why is the president meeting with those? He's not meeting with Moral Mondays, and there's all these established civil rights. I mean, he should meet with the Moral Monday people too. But it just shows you that with enough disruption and leverage and movement, you can get a meeting with the president, which is remarkable. And again, I've done the math. It's about within 7 months of that meeting, Obama visits a federal prison. That's not an accident.
Right.
And no one's gonna convince me that the administration was gonna do that all along. That's not Eric Holder. And I love Eric Holder. Love what the Justice Department has done. But that's disruption. That's like bottom up stuff. That the reason why politicians and top leadership meet with bottom-up grassroots organizations when they don't want to is because they fear larger disruption,
mm-hmm.
Okay? So they fear that the functioning of democracy is imperiled, and they say, I'm going to meet with this group because I don't want it imperiled. It's usually not because of empathy. You're like, man, I'm really upset too by the Black Lives Matter. You know what I mean? I just gotta meet these young people. I'm so angry too. It's usually not that. Although the president now, he's repping Kendrick Lamar. He's like showing out as like super Black, right? You know, that's the President Obama that people wanted to see in 2009. He's saying Kendrick Lamar, the blacker the berry. You know, that's my favorite album of the year.
Wow.
Really? I mean, it's mine too. That's what I want to meet him and tell him. Mine too. It's like we got so much in common.
Yeah. Yeah. As I listen and the policy work y'all are doing is terrific and significantly important, I also and you've got the forest covered and it's emerging, but down in the tree level, I don't want us to lose sight of the need to continue to engage at the community and local levels.
Absolutely.
Whether it's not only the white power structure, but churches, organizations of goodwill.
Yeah, you're right.
You mentioned, for example, the literacy issue. It's a natural. Number one, it builds the army. If we can get these kids literate and we can engage them and their scholarship advances and their commitment advances, that's great. How do we help them if the resources aren't being supplied publicly?
Absolutely.
And it strikes me that with engagement of community organizations who would help on something relatively benign, they could help create this network of the future, call it an army of the future, and they could help to integrate the society so that it's not a we versus them kind of thing. So I just wonder how you react to that, because you guys are up here doing great work. And I think it just struck me that we also have to work at the most fundamental levels, for example, with respect to literacy.
Absolutely. You want to go?
I think one of the first steps of doing that is rethinking how we've approached research agendas within the academy. So the model has been, especially the way that a lot of anthropologists have worked, sociologists have worked to do ethnography, is okay, I'm gonna identify, I wanna do this research into this problem, I'm gonna identify the problem and I'm gonna research it, and it leads to, in some cases, maybe problematic relationships between the scholar and his or her subjects. I think Laurence's brilliant work is an example of getting away from that kind of older model. There's a new movement among historians and other academics, though, to have a more holistic approach to doing research within communities, that we're seeking to figure out how we can improve basic conditions and meet fundamental human needs. And that is, instead of imposing a research agenda on a community, working with the community to shape your own research agenda. So what is it that you would like, instead of going and asking people in a community that you're interested in research in, what is it that you would like me to do, or what questions do you have that you would like to see researched? And I think, again, that goes to a bottom-up filtering up of what some of the social problems are and how we can devise solutions so that we can get more resources to those places so that we can improve literacy and the kind of the larger things that we want to see change, instead of this kind of top-down in imposition, not only of policies, as I talked about, but also of research agendas. So that's one example of approach.
Yeah, and another way that I really appreciate that comment is because of something that Professor Doran mentioned in the last panel, in the sense that when you have a public policy, it's not about today. It's about next week or next year, 5 years from now. And so knowing what the immediate need is allows you to plan better in terms of public policy, because you know, okay, we can have a nonprofit work on literacy for 2 years until we can get the policy that opens the new school, the policy they implement it on a wider level or something like that. But you only know that when you work on an intimate level on the ground with churches, community groups who are dealing with a broad range of social problems.
Yeah, no, I think you're completely right. I mean, when you think about Head Start and Head Start in 65, they're trying it out as a pilot program. It's supposed to be 100,000 kids, and it becomes 560,000 enrolled, when they looked at the people who enrolled in Head Start, and this is multiracial, a lot of the poorest kids were black, but they 70% of them had never gotten a dental exam. 42% had cavities. This is really endemic poverty, and when you see Ferguson, and I'm sure this is the same for Chicago and other cities, one of the things that was striking both in the summer of 14, summer of 15, when you saw young people from Ferguson who were being interviewed, who were really from the community, very, very poor, was they were in bad shape. I mean, it was 2015, and they were 15-year-olds and 13-year-olds with bad teeth, and teeth that were rotting. There's just no care. And you know, some of those kids were the kids who were burning the Wiki Mart and burning the things there. And we wonder, you know, why is that? And it's because they're not getting a level of basic social services and care that, we all take for granted. I mean, quite frankly, we really do. There's a lot of expectations that we have vis-a-vis, like, what, you know, our citizenship, our communities, our healthcare, mental and physical, our time off, our vacation, just so many different things. Our childcare, who's going to take care of our parents? And we demand those things. And then we can't fathom the same thing with New Orleans, Katrina. Many people were castigating the poor for not driving away at the site of the storm. And many of them did not have automobiles. And people were like, well, you know, what do you mean you don't have a car? I'm driving, what do you mean you don't have a car? So it's very interesting just that poverty is such a big part of this. But no, literacy, we completely agree. And part of it is professors getting out into the community, talking to young people, doing that. And it's really just a matter of your time. It's really just a matter of your time. So I give, you know, hundreds of talks, and I've given thousands of talks at this point, and it's just more of your time, but it's hugely important, and also for young people to see that we exist. What's even on stage here, somebody like Laurence Ralph, Elizabeth Hinton, that's not something that's publicized in popular culture. The existence. I mean, both of them are at Harvard. They're both brilliant, and and young people seeing that is hugely important. And it's more than role modeling. It's more of providing a context to make it real that somebody can be inspired. And we all need it in the sense that Obama inspired all of us. You know, like seeing that both Michelle and Barack. Certainly, it gave many people a lift, irrespective of social economic background. So it's great to see people doing great things who you can relate to. So yeah, the community involvement is very important.
Hi, my name is Paige. I am a former UT grad student, and I work with the state in the Family Violence Program. Just first of all, I just wanted to piggyback off what you were saying, Professor Joseph. I'm incredibly motivated now to kind of figure out where I'm going to go next in my academic career. And it's amazing to see young scholars doing so much and being able to have conversations that I feel like are really important and filling a void that we need, I think, in academia across the country. I had a couple of quick questions. So for Professor Hinton, I was just curious, you had mentioned about, you know, kind of changing the way that we look at crime control and, you know, saying that it's a local matter and that neighborhoods can have a much larger role. I was wondering what may be some historical examples that we can draw from for that. And for Professor Ralph, I am not an anthropologist, so I'm just kind of reading off my notes. But you were talking about the theory of social injury and how you're studying how people use the injuries that they suffered as a resource. And it kind of got me thinking about how perhaps the Black Lives Matter movement moment were using injuries that were, in fact, like deadly injuries as a resource so that, and I was just wondering what you kind of thought about that idea of reinterpreting the theory. That's all.
So, and this is probably one of the points where I am literally the most conservative and traditional in early America, before really the mid-19th century, police were really the person on a block or in a neighborhood or in a community who lived in that neighborhood, who, and it was just their job to keep the community safe. They weren't necessarily even, you know, they weren't uniformed. The police forces had not been professionalized. And you were the kind of guardian of your neighborhood. And I think, you know, and this brings up some of the questions that Professor Terry was raising in the last panel about, or earlier today, about what the purpose of police are. So I think that's kind of one historical example of, you know, crime control being this like truly community-based thing. I mean, it's different, you know, when you don't have an outside force. Again, that was to reiterate Baldwin's point, coming into a community, you have somebody who is actually your neighbor. You know everybody on the block. You talk to them, et cetera. More recently, of course, you know, there were some fleeting efforts at kind of either team policing with residents and police officers, or tenant or community-based patrols, where basically youth are responsible for keeping their own communities safe. And so these were some of the programs that we see in the War on Poverty. You see them being funded by the federal government in the War on Crime, and local police departments funding them. And these programs, when people are charged with keeping their own communities safe, it actually does work to reduce crime. So despite the fact that that these programs did successfully prevent robberies, burglaries, violent crime, the federal government ended up defunding them. So I think that's a start. And I think having more police departments are pretty impenetrable. And so having more accountability and more visibility about what's going on, and some kind of check, you know, barring completely rethinking the like landscape of police, some kind of real residential community-based check on police departments. Those are the kind of systemic and structural changes that I really think are necessary if we're not going to continue to kind of put a bandaid on the problem and continue to just funnel new equipment and technologies to police departments. Thank you for the question.
Yeah, and to your question, I totally agree. I think that it is the kind of mobilization that is going on is a resource. I mean, there are dangers that people have been talking about of oversaturation, of the fact that, you know, people don't always want to be confronted by the image, but the way that violence has been mapped and the way that people are communicating through these incidents and how they've provided a basis of comparison between Ferguson and Baltimore and Chicago, like those are actually resources that we can use now to think about what policing means and how to address the problem. And if the idea that they are accidents or particular incidents is something that we need to question. Like, we think of these things as exceptions, but we don't know how exceptional they are because there's no way to measure them. And there's no consensus on what constitutes excessive force, or what constitutes extralegal violence, or what constitutes justifiable homicide. You know, the heart of the matter is that people watching it don't believe that those homicides are justifiable, yet police officers are getting off. So, you know, another way that that's a resource is because we're beginning to change the terms of the debate and beginning to think about what exactly is going on. And I think that this is precisely Elizabeth's point, why like doing the same thing having the same solutions is not going to help. Body cameras are not going to help, because the heart of the matter is that people are looking at the very same images and having different conclusions about what they mean. So what does a body camera of a police officer shooting an unarmed suspect tell us if we already believe before the camera recorded the incident that Black people are criminals and police officers protect, you know, America, right? So once we, you know, don't give police the benefit of the doubt, once we have an idea that, or a nuanced idea of what criminality means or how criminality is created, then we can have a different idea of what constitutes excessive violence, what constitutes justifiable homicide, and begin to hold people accountable for those kind of incidents.
Hi, I'm Marilyn Harris. I'm here as a community activist in the secular humanist social justice area here in Austin. And I have a couple of questions. I believe in education, and this is a forum, this center is a forum, and I have trouble when I'm researching things to educate myself, let alone help educate other people. Someone here spoke about the need to have balanced information from multiple perspectives. And I was just wondering if you guys have resources for how people could educate themselves. And there's two main areas that I'd like to ask about. First is when you don't want the names of the people and the situations to fall by the wayside and be forgotten. Oh, that guy in North Carolina or whatever. Where could one find out in a very unbiased way what these situations are? Is there a resource for that where you have a summary, you have keywords, you have the person's name, you can say this is what the situation was in that instance? And that's one area that I have trouble finding a good balanced reference. There's so much information out there. And then another thing is, and this is the question for the panel too, the resource for where you might find a counter opinion to people that are either anarchists, that don't believe in any kind of policy change, or say revolutionists that think they have to uprise with violence in order to make change. And of course, this academic community is about policy change that can be made through bills and policies and legislation and voting and all of those things. So, so to have a resource where you could send someone to show a balanced view of what why anarchy will not be good and why one shouldn't become violent in a society where a lot of people are so up in arms that we already have war on the streets. And I have heard opinions expressed like that. We're never going to get anywhere through social policy change unless we go to military stuff, you know. So where could one find good resources about that? And then the question for the panel is, what would you say to these anarchists or these revolutionaries, people that really don't believe there's a way to publicize? But I would like to also go somewhere to look at information, because I'm going to not be able to take notes for everything that you can say.
I'd say in terms of information, and right now we're just getting up and running, so we don't have we're working on a website, the whole thing. I think the best thing to do would be just get multiple sources. I mean, I would go to clearinghouses like, you can do anything from Huffington Post. You can go to Socialist Net. There's just many. You can use Breitbart, which is right wing. I mean, I would go to clearinghouses. You know, they're going to have different political ideological perspectives. Some skew center right or hard right. Some skew center left or hard left. And then it would be up to you to sort of, as a critical thinker, make up your mind about that. In terms of violence, though, I don't, I've had this question asked to me before, like, you know, sometimes it's by young people, sometimes by others, like, you know, is violence in 2016 some kind of way forward in social change, for social change? And, I would say no. And one thing as historians we know is that we've actually seen and witnessed, and we document a period when we think about the 1960s and the 1970s, where there was groups of radicals who at times talked about self-defense, but also talked about proactive revolutionary violence. So think of everybody from, you know, not just the Black Panthers to Students for a Democratic Society, but, you know, Black Liberation Army, SLA. There were many, the Weathermen or Weather Underground. There were just many groups, Days of Rage in Chicago in 69, and they were making the argument that because state-sanctioned violence was so, the depth and breadth of state-sanctioned violence justified, one, self-defense. You think about Malcolm X, self-defense. But then two, even trying to do some kind of violent sort of guerrilla warfare, people used to talk about, that was very reminiscent of what was happening in Latin America, in Africa, and other parts of the world at the time. I think we've seen how that played out. And it played out in a very, very negative way, both for the participants in that and their families. And sometimes people who were not connected to that have wound up in jail and really are political prisoners because they were loosely affiliated with movements like that, or maybe ideologically affiliated, but not necessarily proactive participants. So no, I think that substantive fundamental change in a democratic society comes from nonviolent social change. You know, I think it comes from, and it doesn't mean you can't be disruptive, because civil disobedience is massively disruptive. Martin Luther King Jr., I think that, and I've written this, I think people like Stokely Carmichael were wrong when it came to King and nonviolence. I think that there was a misunderstanding of how powerful King's nonviolence was, when it was especially mixed with an effort at economic justice to transform liberal democratic capitalism. So King, remember, he's assassinated not leading an army of violent people with a pitchfork at the White House. He's assassinated helping out striking garbage men in Memphis, Tennessee, and they're doing a poor people's campaign, which includes women in the National Welfare Rights Organization, to set up Resurrection City. So he's assassinated Thursday, April 4th, 1968, and Resurrection City is going to go up that June. But part of the reason why King's assassinated is because he's got the moral and political power globally, not domestically, to move the legislation he was trying to get passed. He wanted Congress to finally address poverty in a fundamental structural way, both urban and rural, but also Black, Mexican American, Native American, white. He had a mule train. He had everybody in there. And there's great work on this too, going down Jericho Road by Michael Honey is the definitive account, but also Thomas F. Jackson, which we're reading in my civil rights class, From Civil Rights to Human Rights, is a great account of King's political thought. And then you get Taylor Branch and others, Diane McWhorter's book on Birmingham with King as well. So, no, violence, and again, if certain sectarian groups are talking about violence, you know, that's what folks can do in sectarian groups. So there's sectarians on the right and left who might talk about violence. On the right, Southern Poverty Law Center has documented those who are talking about killing Obama, killing the president, the rise of hate groups since 2008 in the election. And on the left, you might have some people who are self-described revolutionaries talking about violence, but I don't think that's where the movement we're seeing now is going at all. Yeah.
Hi, my name is Leonie Jones, and I work at the Institute for Urban Policy Research and Analysis, and I just have a quick response to that lady's question. I have a quick response to your question. So in addition to Dr. Joseph's options on research and how to get more information. The institute that I work at, we are developing a death in custody. We've already developed a death in custody database where you can go and see the people who have died in police custody in Texas. And what that'll do, like how you said, making sure that it's not just that person in North Carolina, and in this case, that person in Texas, you could go and see that. And what one of our postdocs has done is called the police departments in Texas to keep them accountable in case they didn't know about the policies that required them to report it, and she called them and made sure that they were up to date. So it is a up-to-date database.
No, that's a great intervention. And one thing I should have added is that the Guardian newspaper out of London has an up-to-date data based on police shootings and killings of everyone, not just African Americans, over the last maybe 17 months. But they've also done a global database too. So they're documenting every killing. And that's why the young lady's gone now, but that's why data and research is always important. You can't, and I think Ida B. Wells taught us that, you've got to, she serves as the first social scientific public witness as a journalist, just making sure that every lynching is documented, because she knows how important it is, even though in her time, you know, there's no justice. There's absolutely no justice. Even though we've gotten some justice for civil rights era killings, we haven't had any justice for lynchings. You know, there's no justice there. But it's important that we know, and what we're doing now, and even Northeastern is documenting every single lynching that occurred, and that's Margaret Burnham, the law professor there. And they've got a great project that shows you where, what time. And people might think that that's grim, but it's hugely important. It's hugely important because it gives you an understanding of American society, American politics, democracy, then and now. It's hugely important that a society that we recognize and we acknowledge that happened, because it happened to all of us too, even though sometimes we try to run and hide from it. It really did. It happened, and it's happening to us right now. Yeah. So we'll do. I think we'll do. How many people have questions? Okay, so we'll do one more, and then we'll wrap it up.
Hi, my name is Autumn, and I want to say thank you very much. This has been very enlightening. My question is, as a mother and a grandmother of biracial children, it's very important to me that they embrace and they understand the importance of their heritage, both white, African American, and for my grandchildren of other ethnicities as well. And so I am curious as to how you would recommend that we help them to embrace all of their races, all of their ethnicity, yeah, without losing a part of it. I know with the one drop rule and the way that the government does our census, that kind of gets lost in the data. And I'm kind of saddened that it's something that's kind of been lost with the Obama administration, because I think it's something that his biracialness could have been highlighted to kind of help bring us together more. So I kind of am curious as to your feedback on that and how we could help our children to embrace both being white and being African-American and being of other races.
Yeah, no, that's a great question. I think, you know, there's you know, in terms of the census and you know, you can check off multiple identities and multiple categories now. I think Obama is complicated, and, you know, biracialism is complicated in the sense that Obama certainly says that he understands that he's the product of a biracial marriage union, but he identifies as a black man. And I think that that becomes at times difficult for white parents to understand, because most biracial children and then adults really will not have the luxury of, in some kind of even, and Elizabeth is going to talk about this in a second, in some kind of equitable way to identify with both heritages at the same level, because they're being identified externally, phenotypically, right? They're being externalized and saying, you know, you're black, or if somebody does not look to be black, you're white. So certainly intellectually they can appreciate both, but the way in which they're gonna go out in the world, especially if they look as if they're African American or mixed, means that external forces, and it depends on how they read the history. You know, I would hope that they could proudly identify as being black and also as being white, but in the world, they are going to be perceived a lot of times as black. And that's what Obama, you know, Dreams from My Father is all about that. It's all about, and I teach that book, it's all about this young man coming to terms with his biracial heritage and being, having been raised by white grandparents and a mother who led a peripatetic existence and a father who he only met once when he was 10 years old. For a very short amount of time, he's trying to find out who he is, you know, and you know, he's reading Frederick Douglass, he's reading Malcolm X. Can you imagine Obama with Malcolm X? And he's trying to come to terms with all this, and he decides that you know, yes, he loves his white mother and his Kansas roots. And but he understands, and he comes to grips with, and really embraces, you know, that he's a black man, and he you know, he's moved on in the world accordingly. So I think that your kids, your grandkids, it really just depends. Some other biracial folks have a strategy of saying that they're exclusively both, or somehow they're colorblind, you know. I think that's problematic politically, but it's their personal choice. Because by the time you're embracing colorblindness, it's racism, colorblind racism. This idea that none of us see color, and we also don't care about disparities and outcomes, and we proclaim ourselves equal. But then, equally as pernicious is, from my perspective, the Tiger Woods, the Kablan Asian thing, where you're anything but black because you realize how bad being black is in this society, and you're trying to get out of it. You see what I'm saying? Mm-hmm. So that's the problem. And so white parents don't want, and grandparents don't want their kids to suffer, but blackness doesn't have to be suffering. It can also be embracing the beauty, and that's what Barack Obama's mother told him. She told him that Harry Belafonte was the best looking man on the planet Earth, and that he had been bequeathed this history of struggle, right? Because black people had these burdens that only they could bear, but they were strong enough to bear them. And so instead of having to run and say, you know, Barack Obama, I'm Irish, even though he looks the way he looks, he's embraced it, which I think is, you know, the ethical strategy. But I also think, again, there's many, many biracial folks who are doing something different.
Are you sure you're not biracial? Because you perfectly articulated. I don't really have much to add to that. I am biracial myself. My mom is Jewish. My father is African American, and I think that you know, I come from a very militant household, so. You know, I've always had a lot of pride about my ancestors, my black ancestors, and what we've overcome. It was kind of like run down my throat. But the reality is that I'm bred as a black woman, and I embrace that identity, but I know what my identity is fully. For me, actually, I have been, you know, especially when growing up, I've come to terms with it, but white people, or especially Jewish people, don't accept me as Jewish. Like, I'm much more accepted within black communities than within white communities. I think that the thing is that people who are biracial, a lot of us feel like you never really fit in anywhere fully. And so the place that I feel the most comfortable and where I do feel like I fit in the most are in spaces with communities of color, especially African American communities, because that's how I'm read, that's how I'm perceived. I live my life in the world as a Black woman on the outside. So I think part of it is, and much of it is going between two segregated spaces. I think a lot of times people are compartmentalized, and it's constantly dealing with the reality of American segregation. So that's kind of the burden of not fitting in fully anywhere. And it wasn't until I went to New York City that, you know, for the first time I was able to kind of come to terms with what my identity is. But that was because I was fully in an integrated group of friends with all different kinds of backgrounds, and I had never experienced that before growing up in Michigan. You know, and it's so where it's like, okay, Black friends, white friends, what side of the cafeteria are you going to sit on today? So I'm losing my train of thought. I was going to say something else, but
That's good.
Yeah.
Do you want to say something?
Having a complex background is an asset too, and I think that, like, my parents are from Guyana, South America. I was born here in the States. I'm read as African American, and I'm fine. I identify as African American. I appreciate my Caribbean roots. If I'm in a Caribbean community and they say something disparaging about African Americans, I take offense to that. And because I have a complex, and so because I know that that is a kind of artificial divide used to create hierarchies, and so I have that within me. But if I was in a community and someone, you know, called me homosexual as an insult, I wouldn't be offended by the fact that they identify me as a homosexual, because I don't think anything's wrong with the identity, but I still would be offended by the fact that they thought that was an insult. And so I think it allows you to have a kind of complex idea of both stigma and identity that you can use in a variety of situations because you understand the kind of complexity of you know, humanity, and it's in you. And so I think that's an asset. Your kids.
It took me. Oh, I think I remember part of what it takes. It takes a very long time. And Peniel was talking about this with Obama. I think to come to terms with negotiating that identity. It's not something that that happens smoothly. And I think, you know, for my sister's kids who are adults and who can pass, they embrace their Blackness, but they also know that they navigate the world as white people. Yeah. My niece actually was who's a quarter African American, was dating an African American man for a number of years, and now she's dating a white man, and she's like, wow, this is a totally different experience I never had before, walking into a restaurant and just being treated like. And that's something that biracial people I have no idea what it's like to navigate the world with white skin, just like people with white skin have no idea what it's like to navigate the world in my skin. And so I think that's part of why, you know, we're putting these places where we embrace the ways in which society views us. But that doesn't mean that you're pushing away or that you are shunning a side of you. I mean, I'm sure that some people do, but I think it sounds like in your family there's an awareness of both sides of it. And so in some ways it's up to the parents to make sure that people know that their kids know their history, know their family history. And I certainly do on both sides.
All right, so we're gonna close. We're gonna close out. Thank you everybody for coming. Thank you for this inaugural Race, Public Policy, and Democracy Conference. Thank you for coming.